Well, I'm Laura McFarland. Thank you for stopping by Cross My Heart Ministry. I want to thank you for spending a few minutes of your afternoon with us. Well, like all the rest of America, you and I are continuing to live through some very challenging and extraordinary times. We are suffering and struggling. We are enduring and pushing on. Many of us are adapting to a new normal, and certainly all of us are looking forward to the day that life returns to normal, and certainly doing no small degree of wondering what that new normal will look like. Our leaders are working hard for us. They are leaning in and trying to make good decisions, and certainly we are praying for them. We are praying for those who are doing the research to try to find a vaccine for this virus that has so crippled and changed our lives in so many different ways. And certainly we can all say that whether we are merely inconvenienced or whether we are on the other end of the spectrum and truly suffering, this is a time of trouble. Many of you know that I blog over to reasonforhomeschool.com, and one of the things that I create each month over there is this monthly bookmark, where I choose a key word and then I find 30 or 31 verses depending on what the month, and drop in a verse for each day of the month, encouraging our readers to not only read that verse but to write that verse out. I think there's power in not just reading but writing the Word of God. With this particular month, because of what we are all enduring and facing and living through, I chose verses that don't necessarily have a specific word in each one, but every single one of these verses applies to a time of trouble. So what I'm hoping and praying is that as you read and as you write each one of these verses, and I hope you will, I'll add a link below in the comments section that you can follow to download your own copy, or at least just to pull it up and then write it in your journal. But I believe that God's Word can be a balm to our hurting heart. I believe that God's Word can prompt us to pray back to God, His Word, when we seem to struggle to have words of our own to pray to Him. Yes, we are facing times of trouble. We're in big trouble, but we serve a great big God. When I was a little girl, one of my favorite things to watch after school were reruns of Batman. Did any of you do that? I'm not talking about the movies of today, but the old original series. And I remember the commissioner saying to Batman, "Batman, we have trouble right here in Gotham City." Well, folks, whether you watched Batman back in the day or whether you're old enough to remember that old series, I know all of us would absolutely agree that we have trouble right here in our hometown. We have trouble right here in America. The trouble is not just something that we're watching in a far-off land or off in a great big city. Trouble has come to us. And when trouble comes, it really is a time that what is in our hearts is revealed. Trouble is an opportunity for us to stand in faith. It reveals what's in our hearts. We can not just survive this, but we can draw near to God through this. We need not give in to fear. We need not give in to frenzied activity. We need not panic, but it is an opportunity for us to draw near to God and actually have our faith strengthened and bolstered. And I believe that is possible as we draw near to God. So I hope and pray that during this next month, which incidentally is the month of May, and that's the month that we celebrate annually the National Day of Prayer. Many of us as believers are used to drawing together with others on that first Thursday in May to pray and to seek the Lord. And so using this bookmark and this idea, I would love to challenge you to join with me in making prayer not just one day in May, but every day in May. Could we do that? And so as we covenant together to do that, I'd like to unpack one key verse on here. It's one that if you have ever observed the National Day of Prayer, you're probably familiar with. But on day two, I've chosen 2 Chronicles 7:14 as the verse that we will read and write and pray. Now, many of you hear that and you say, "Oh yeah, yeah, I know that one. I've read that one." And most likely you do know that and you have read that one, because it is very familiar to those who have followed Christ and observed the National Day of Prayer. But I'd like for you to indulge me just a couple of minutes here. Let's sort of dissect this verse together and see if we can maybe unearth some new truth or some old truth for our new challenging times together. When this verse opens, and it is God speaking, the temple has been dedicated and the Lord has appeared to Solomon. And so these are words that God is speaking to Solomon and by extension to us. And he says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. There's an if-then statement in this verse. There's language here that's covenant language. God says, if we do this, then he will do that. And he says, if my people who are called by my name, my people, he says, that's you and me. If you're a follower of Jesus Christ, you are one of God's own. When we claim the name Christian, we are identifying ourselves with Christ. So this is calling us out. This is saying, my people, pray, come, seek my face. And he has four things that he is assigning us to do, dear friends. He says that if we will, first of all, humble ourselves. You know, if we are coming to God in a spirit of prayer, I think it's difficult not to be humbled. When you come to God, you are coming into his presence and keenly aware of who he is and who you are not. As we come to God, often we bow down, don't we? We bow our heads or sometimes we bow our knee. And I think that physical posture is intended to point to the attitude, the posture of our hearts, the posture of our minds, that we should come to God in that spirit of humility as we approach him, reverently, respectfully, acknowledging that he is a holy God. We come before him in humility. God says if we will humble ourselves. And then he says, and if we will pray. If we will pray. Now, if we took a vote amongst our churches or our small groups or our Bible studies and said, who's for prayer? Who believes in prayer? Of course, we would all obediently raise our hands. Yes, we are for prayer. But if we honestly answer the question, how much do we pray? Do we pray intentionally? Do we pray consistently? Do we pray every day? Do we pray for more than a pair of minutes? If suddenly our country outlawed prayer, we as followers of Christ would grab our placards and our signs and we would march and protest and demand our right to pray. But yet what we have freedom to do, we have forfeited and we fail to do. I want to accept the Lord's challenge to pray. I am chief among sinners in this area, friends. I need to cultivate and strengthen my own prayer life. I'm working on that, but I'm not where I should be. I praise God, I'm not where I used to be, but I'm not yet where I need to be either. He says, if you will pray, and then he adds, and seek my face. Now, what's the difference between praying and seeking God's face? I've been thinking a lot about that this week because I've been reading a book called Living Out of the Overflow by Richard Blackaby. I'm studying this with an online study this month, and it chronicles the life at the beginning of Elijah, and then later it will get to Moses, the two individuals that God called up to meet with Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration. But as you look at Elijah's story and you consider his life, many ups and downs in his life. But one thing I want to read to you specifically, this is the piece of his story where he has gone to live with the widow and her son. The widow's son has died. She almost accuses him and holds him responsible. And as Elijah picks up that dead boy's body and prays over him, it describes it in scripture as him crying out. And I want to read to you the wise words of Richard Blackaby as he unpacks this passage for us. Richard says this, a prayer can be respectable, liturgical, and even poetic, but a cry reflects desperation. We cry when there is nothing left to do. We cry when we know that unless a response is immediately forthcoming, tragedy will ensue. Perhaps that reality is why revival eludes us. Could it be that many of God's servants are saying prayers for revival, but too few are desperately crying out for it? Friends, I want to be a woman of passion when I pray. I want to cry out to the Lord in prayer. I want to ask and keep asking until I am in alignment with who he is. It's interesting to think about our Lord Jesus Christ even setting the example for us in prayer as he came before the Father in the Garden of Gethsemane, knowing that he was facing the resurrection the next day. He spent his time in prayer. And he didn't just repeat a poetic phrase, I think that scripture makes it clear that Jesus cried out in prayer. And as he prayed to his heavenly Father on that night, he asked if there's any other way to take this cup from him. And he just kept pushing in. He kept persevering in prayer. And he knew he was prayed up, and he knew he was finished when he said, "Thy will be done. Thy will be done." And I believe that that's what prayer does for us as well. It brings us into alignment with what God's plans are. Sometimes we approach prayer as if God is the servant and we are the master. And we just sort of say, change this, fix her, heal him, and God, do it snappy. Instead of coming in reverence before a holy God and praying and keep on praying until we come into alignment with what God's plans are, instead of trying to sort of manufacture or manipulate our own request to manipulate God to do what we want him to do. So God says, if my people will humble themselves, if they'll pray, if they'll seek my face, and then he says, and if they will turn from their wicked ways. And so you see, I think that's what happens as we come in prayer before God. We are convicted. We begin to have our eyes open to realize that we are culpable. Because I don't think you can come before God in, at least I can't, in my sinfulness, in my wickedness, before a holy God and not see how far I am lacking, see what my needs are. And so prayer may come in praise and thankfulness and worship and petition, but it always ends up including some confession as well when we stand before a holy God. And God promises then, if we do those four things, humble ourselves, pray, seek his face, and then turn from our wicked ways. And that turning, even that turning, is only possible through him and through his Spirit. He brings the conviction, and then he provides the means. We can't do it on our own. He does it all. We come to him and we confess, and then he helps us to cleanse and to change and to turn. This is not legalism. This is not a list of have-tos, my dear friend. This is freedom from bondage. This is letting go and letting him do it. And then look what he says that he will do. If we do those four things, it says, first of all, God says that I will hear. Isn't that extraordinary? The creator of the universe hears us. You know, we can try to gain an audience with the mayor or the governor or the president or the chairman of the committee or the CEO of the office, whatever, important people we can't always connect with. They don't always have time or can make time for us. But our God, our great God, the holy, perfect God who spoke this world into existence, he is available to us 24/7. And the amazing thing is, he's so vast and so mighty and so wise that he can listen to all of us individually, gently, all at the same time. He is God Almighty, and he hears us when we pray. And he says, so I will hear from heaven, and I will forgive their sin. Isn't that amazing? That all we have to do is ask, and he will forgive. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. What are we lugging around? What are we carrying around, weighted down, that we don't need to carry anymore? We just need to confess and let him have it. Perhaps there's some individual sin, but perhaps even some corporate sin that we need to confess. And look what God says. He will hear, he will forgive, and he will heal our land. Isn't that what we want? We want healing from this virus. We want healing from so many things. Healing in God's economy, though, I want to caution you, God's ways are not our ways. Isaiah 55:8-9 tells us that God's ways and God's thoughts are higher and mightier than our own. So in God's economy, healing may look very different. Sometimes we just want to push that stop button and make it all go away right now. But God sees eternity. We see what's right before us. But he is trustworthy, and he is loving, and he is compassionate. Let's covenant together. Let's try this every day during the month of May. Pray these verses back to him, or verses of your own. Allow the Holy Spirit to prompt you what to pray. I have found it powerful to read the word, write the word, and pray the word. And I want to invite you to do that with me during the month of May. If you have trouble and I think we all have trouble right now, then I think it's high time to pray. And so I've even put together a little hashtag that I'm going to be using called hashtag high noon, high time. And so what I'm going to commit to do is to every day, the Lord willing, at noon, I'm going to post a new comment below with a short prayer inspired by that verse of that day that I'm praying back to God. I'll put that over on Facebook, on my ministry page as well for Cross My Heart Ministry. I'll put it below. I want to encourage you to write your own prayer, to put your own verse out there. And maybe we can use that same hashtag, high noon, high time. And at noon, I'm going to stop, drop, and pray every single day. I'm not trying to make this anything legalistic. I just want to observe the National Day of Prayer on my own and invite all of you, my friends, to join with me in praying. Let's pray every day in the month of May for our country, for our families, for our communities, for our government leaders, for those who are working to find the cure for this virus, because we do have trouble. We have trouble in America corporately, and we have trouble right here in our individual towns, in our individual communities. We have trouble. We have big trouble. But friends, we serve a great big God. Would you join me in praying every day in the month of May? Thank you for spending this time with me today. I'm Lauren McFarland. This is Cross My Heart Ministry.